Good evening, everyone, or a good late afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this webinar on healthcare management in post-COVID India. I'm joined in this webinar by my faculty colleagues, Professor Tarun Jain and Professor Anindya Chakrabarty right now. And we will also have our other teaching colleagues, Professor Tathagata Bandyopadhyay and Professor Devjit Roy joining us in just a bit. My plan was to quickly introduce ourselves in the beginning, then show you some slides on the plan and the motivation for this particular course. And then my respective faculty colleagues will share their bits on the modules they will teach on their area of specialization. And then we turn it over to you for some Q&A and we'll wrap it up. So very quickly, I'll just quickly introduce myself. I am a economics and strategy area faculty member here at IIM Ahmedabad. And I do my research in healthcare economics and management. Over the last 10 years, there has been a spate of research on this, and my research has been funded both by local and international organizations. I also maintain a visiting fellow affiliation with the Hoover Institution in Stanford University. And over the years, I have taught various cadres of healthcare professionals, both at the middle and top management level, for specific customized programs for organizations, local as well as multinationals. And also generic programs for my previous employers, which was IIM Bangalore and Indian School of Business. I will now turn it over to Professor Tarun Jain to introduce himself and then Professor Anindya Chakrabarty.
So hi everyone, my name is Tarun Jain. I'm a professor of economics at IIM Ahmedabad. And a lot of my work and interest in working in healthcare management is to think about how markets work in healthcare and why is it that oftentimes the same market principles that you can apply to many other contexts don't work in healthcare. And so healthcare is a unique market where there's a lot of special economics that you have to think about and you have to apply in a sensitive and creative way. And so my real world experience in working with healthcare has been largely in the work of research of associated with tertiary care, and particularly the design and implementation of large scale public health insurance programs, particularly Arogyashri in Andhra Pradesh. So that's been my background. And so I turn it over to Anindya Chakrabarty. And so he's going to talk more about his background.
Thanks, Tarun and Chiranthan. Good afternoon, everyone. This is Anindya Chakrabarty. I am a faculty in the economics area at IIM Ahmedabad. And I'm a macroeconomist, but for the last couple of years, I have been working in the intersection of data analytics, mostly in the pharmaceutical sector, with the intersection with economics. And one way to think about that is how big data is changing the face of public policy, especially with a focus on the pharmaceutical markets. I am also currently the chairperson for the High Performance Computing Lab here at IMA and the co-chairperson for business analytics course that we offer at IIM Ahmedabad. So I have a very deliberate and latent interest in large scale data and how they are analyzed and how they are converted into public policy from the point of view of pharmaceutical markets and healthcare. And towards the end of the discussion, hopefully we'll be able to explain, some more points in a few more details. For the time being, welcome you all to the discussion. I'll turn it over to Professor Bandyopadhyay, who can give a short intro. Thank you.
You're on mute.
Welcome to IIMA webinar on healthcare management in post-COVID India. So I am a faculty member of production and quantitative methods area. Basically, my interest is the application of statistics and probability theory in different fields, as well as I do methodological research in probability statistics basically. So I would not take much time. I would like to tell you two examples of applications of probability and statistics in healthcare management that would tell you that why probability and statistics is so important in the application of healthcare management. So first, let me tell you one simple example. You know that we are doing a lot of testing, RT-PCR testing, okay? So now the question is that initially, at least, we had a kind of shortage of testing kits. And because of that, then people started about thinking whether we can do something called group testing, okay? And even ICMR also agreed that you can do group testing. So what is the idea of group testing? The idea is very simple. Suppose you collect swab samples of 5 patients, and then what you do, you mix it together and then carry out the RT-PCR test on the mixed sample. And suppose the test result is negative. So then what does it mean? It means that none of the 5 people have been infected. So in one test, you actually can cover 5 people. But if it is positive, then it means that at least one of them has been infected. So do an individual test in that case. So in the first case, for 5 tests, you need 1 test. And for the second case, for 5 tests, you need 6 tests. Now the question is, if the prevalence of this particular disease, in this case, COVID-19, is very low, then the chance of or probability of happening the first one is much higher compared to the second one. And that's why eventually the number of tests, kit that you will use, would be much lower if you go for individual testing. So I'll explain this using how probably simple probability theory can be used to understand this logic. So this is one. The second story I would like to tell you, that the director of IIPH Gandhinagar, he is a friend of mine. So he often calls me for different statistical kind of advice. So a month ago, he called me. He said, Tathagata, we got data from Gujarat government on 60,000 COVID patients, reported COVID-19 patients. So there is a hypothesis already there in the scientific community that there are people who are not at all susceptible to COVID, even if they are exposed, or they are not vulnerable. So how to test that hypothesis? So he thought, out of these 60,000 people, he will select a random sample of, say, 700 people, and he has their phone numbers, and he would call them and ask them, in your family, how many got infected? Suppose this guy is the primary, got the primary infection. So first question he asked me, how would I select my sample? Okay, so sampling is very important. Otherwise, the conclusion that you will draw from your sample about the population will be invalid. Second, the question he asked me, what sample size I would require so that I can draw my conclusion with some accuracy. So sample size determination is another problem that needs help of probability and statistics. I answered both the questions. And then what he is doing, actually he's shared with me some results already what they have got. So they have actually interviewed 700 people, and they found, in the result what they found, that the percentage of secondary infection in each family is 6.7%. That clearly tells you that around 94% are not getting infected in the same family, even though in that family a person got infected. So possibly this indicates that there are some individuals who are not at all vulnerable, or they are not susceptible, even if you expose them. And if that is true, it's a fantastic news for us, because assuming that there won't be any reinfection, then if suppose 50% of Indians are not vulnerable to COVID, then we will very soon reach the herd immunity. That's the implication of the whole research. So you can see, but do this research, you need data, and to draw conclusion from data, you need statistics and probability, because what is happening when you are drawing conclusion from your sample, that is subject to some uncertainty. Because if I take another sample of say 700 people from the same population, I might have got a different estimate of the percentage of secondary infection. The question is then, with what confidence I can say that the actual true percentage of secondary infection lies in an interval like this, between this to this. So for that, you need to use what is called confidence interval in statistics. So basically, in the five lectures that I will deliver, I will take some examples like this and small data sets, and I will try to explain the statistical concepts or the probability concepts that would be useful to draw conclusions from the data when your conclusion is subject to some uncertainty. I think I should stop here.
Thank you, Professor Bandyopadhyay. He may have to leave. He's also Dean Faculty at IIM Ahmedabad. He has a busy schedule. I'm okay. I think we are going to share what he will do. I'll just quickly go over the slides you have for this course and just try to motivate the reason for this course at this point in. We say it's post-COVID, but COVID hasn't yet passed India. So we are going through COVID. But at the same time, I guess the course is about recognizing where we were pre-COVID, what has happened during COVID, and how we are going to think about improving healthcare management in India post-COVID, or even for the next COVID in some sense. So to explain all of that, I want to draw from an example that famous economist Amartya Sen talks about in his book, The Idea of Justice, about how you should allocate a flute lying on the ground. And the discussion he has in that book is about these three individuals, Carla, who is the maker of the flute, Bob, the poor boy, who is also has some property rights to the flute, and Anne, the musician who can play the flute and really create mellifluous music. And the question that Sen asks is, whom should the flute go to? And if you look at this, if you think about the flute as like Indian healthcare, you can start thinking about how Indian healthcare in the last 10 or 15 years has been this constant jostles between the Carlas, the Bobs, and the Anns. At one end, we have the folks who are producing healthcare, hospitals, farms, diagnostic devices, farms, pharmaceutical and vaccine manufacturers, et cetera. At the other end, we also have people who don't have access to healthcare at the base of the pyramid, the healthcare egalitarians, and there's a constant discussion to use public policy to enhance access. And then we also have the intervening intermediaries like physicians and other agents who are talking about letting the market decide who should get healthcare. And this jostle is basically resulting in all the discussions on management issues in healthcare on the supply side, management issues in healthcare on the demand side, operations and economics and externality issues, information asymmetry between provider for healthcare, et cetera, et cetera. So taking this big picture idea of the fight that is going on between the egalitarians, libertarians, and utilitarians, we can immediately point to a few big picture issues that we are all dealing with and we are aware of in Indian healthcare. The first is, of course, Soumya Swaminathan has said the other day from WHO that one of the big learnings from COVID is that we seem to have, and we had knew it, we had an inadequate public health expenditure. And also that there is a lot of heterogeneity within the country. The southern part of the country is very different from, let's say, the northern or the eastern part of the country. And even within that, there are differences both on disease burden as well as on supply of healthcare. So this is one big picture issue that was there pre-COVID. It has potentially been exacerbated during COVID. There was also a philosophical discussion on who gets the right to healthcare, and that too, is right to healthcare the one which should be given of first importance, or right to quality healthcare that should be given the first importance? Accordingly, we saw the entry over the last maybe three decades of hospitals, especially from private entrepreneurs, either unispeciality or multispeciality, were basically trying to use business models and design thinking to solve the supply gap that is there through public healthcare in the country. And in the process, if you go through these business school studies, you will know about how they have created what are called focus factories, how they have created division of labor between specialist physicians and non-specialist physicians, how they're trying to solve the issue of lesser number of healthcare workers per capita that is there in the country, and also how, let's say, clinician entrepreneurs have emerged in the country in from different backgrounds and antecedents to try to solve the gap that exists between public healthcare from the supply side and what is required for a country as large as ours. Of course, as they have come in, we also know that the regulator, the policymaker, either at the center or at the state level, have tried to use regulation to make sure that the prices are not completely free market driven and quality is maintained, which has created a variety of distortions in the market. Some short run, some long run. Tarun will cover this also, and I will also cover this in my sessions. These has problematic consequences for the patient welfare under consideration. And then apart from that, healthcare financing is a big issue. We know that there are state and center level universal healthcare coverage initiatives over the last 15, 20 years. And then there has been a large penetration these days of private health insurance. Recent trends point to that with the footfall of patients in hospitals diminishing, many hospitals, perhaps some faster than others, have transitioned into a telemedicine model. And then we have to have better understanding of as to who is able to switch from the conventional method of healthcare provisioning to a digital provisioning. Should there be a make or buy trade-off that is appearing in terms of the software they use? How do you take care of patient outcomes when you transition into digital health outcomes, into digital health, etc.? And of course, as we do all this, we also have to be cognizant of issues around patient centricity and trust deficit. We know in the last 2 or 3 years, there were doctors who were getting mauled up by patients because inappropriate care was being provided. And there was a lot of debates around, especially the Western and Eastern part of the country, on this having an implication for provision of care and provision of quality care, and also what that means for patients in the long run. All this is being done not just by, let's say, submarkets of hospitals, but also an ecosystem of biopharmaceutical firms, device and diagnostic firms. And India has a traditional, you would say, comparative advantage in the world in making vaccines, those firms as well. So we would have an opportunity while we talk about all this to look at all the supply side issues, the demand side issues, the public policy issues, and how innovation has played a role in sometimes solving and sometimes leaving things unsolved in terms of creating efficiencies for Indian healthcare management. And of course, we'll try to break it all out into three phases: the pre-COVID phase, where we were, the phase during COVID, what we have seen in the last 7 months, and in the long run and short run, whatever we have learned or have failed in provisioning for healthcare, what can it mean in terms of organizational learnings for Indian healthcare market participants, and what managerial lessons you can get as a result to improve your context where you are joining from in provisioning of better healthcare in India. We have an interdisciplinary faculty team, as you have already evidenced. We have Tarun, who will take care of healthcare economics. We have Pratagatha, who will take care of statistics for healthcare professionals. We also will have Anindya, who will take care for big data and healthcare analytics, and Debjit, who will talk about strategic operations management for healthcare. And I will talk a little bit about strategic management, entrepreneurship, business models, and innovations in the context of healthcare for different submarkets and different organizations who are operating in healthcare. Our pedagogical tools will be standard, but at the same time, slightly experimental given the virtual worlds we are living in. So we will definitely use our lectures, case studies, mini cases, and video cases virtually. But we'll also try to use features on Zoom that already has given us in our long duration program teaching the facility to use like polls and breakout rooms to facilitate these case discussions. In healthcare, it is also useful sometimes to use role play. So we'll call out you folks to do role play in classes. We'll try to sometimes flip the classes. We'll become learners and we'll try to learn from you in terms of what you are seeing from your organizational context, what has happened pre, during, and what you anticipate to happen tomorrow in Indian healthcare context. And of course, some of the data stuff that Anindya will teach will probably also sensitize you to some simulations with spreadsheets, etc., and we'll try to give a little bit of hands-on exposure to how big data in the context of healthcare can improve your analytical thinking and decision-making in the context of healthcare. The ideal candidates we feel are middle and top-level healthcare managers, and we are being agnostic here. Although we have specified a few pockets of professionals like entrepreneurs, investors, policymakers, not-for-profit ecosystem, or physician managers and entrepreneurs, essentially anybody who wants to add value and cares about improving Indian healthcare, I think are welcome to join this course. And we are very happy to engage with you and walk with you in your journey to care to improve Indian healthcare going forward. In terms of operational logistics, we will have like about about 6 weeks going till January 2nd. Week one will be started by me, and then I'll hand it over to Tarun for week one and two, where he'll cover health economic concepts. Then Professor Tathagata will come in week three on statistical issues in healthcare. Anindya will then complement his lessons on statistics with healthcare, big data, and analytics. Professor Devjit Roy will come in week five, taking it to the field for practitioners, especially in strategic operations management. And then we come back again with me to wrap up the course with the module on innovation and entrepreneurship. So that's how we are envisioning the sequence of classes and sessions, 5 sessions for each module for each one of us. And hopefully that will all help in asking some hard questions, finding some answers, learning together, and solving the healthcare issues for about 1.3 billion Indians. Because what I have learned over time with my research, talking with international colleagues, both in the practice, policy, and research space, is that if you solve Indian healthcare today, you can actually solve healthcare for the world in many ways, with scalable models, with business model innovation, with entrepreneurship, with policy and experimental thinking, et cetera, et cetera. So we look forward to make this sessions engaging and worthwhile, learning for you as well as for us, taking Indian healthcare forward. So that's it. And we can now take some questions. And when Devjit joins, he might have some thoughts to share.
Thank you all for joining this webinar on the healthcare for post-COVID. I'm Devjit Roy. I'm a faculty in the operations management area. My core expertise has been in the area of service operations, mostly looking at logistics, also in the front of healthcare logistics and operations. So where I fit in the course is exactly looking at, if you think the post-COVID times, the nature of the streams of the patients are going to be quite variable. You already saw a lot of the variability in the case of patients and the volumes in the past few months, but how do you manage variability, right? So this is very similar if you're talking about e-commerce. How does Amazon or Flipkart manage the large variability during this big billion day sales? Well, you have to plan for it. And while we say that we do not like variability, we just cannot completely live without it. Variability is there. So in the case of healthcare, particularly looking at either it is going to be diagnostics, or it is going to be in the case of hospital admissions, or it is going to be in terms of whether the healthcare infrastructure, the prime question, the moot question is that given this volatility in the volumes of the patients, and more so in the coming times, how do you really prepare ourselves, right? So one part of the whole equation is looking at how do you manage the capacity of your facilities? That is one thing. I have always seen this question, not just in healthcare, but also in other service operations, is the wait times. And it becomes even more important for patients, because every 10 minutes of wait time, every 5 minutes of wait time could be life-threatening. So in healthcare, while we're talking about wait times, I think we really need to understand the implications of the wait times. So the second part, once we firm our foundations on the capacity analysis, we'll try to understand what are the factors that drive the wait times of the patients, and how can we really manage those wait times, particularly for the critical patients. In particular, we always say that patient volumes is something we cannot control, but we can definitely control our internal processes. So we'll spend some time looking at some of the dysfunctional variabilities in the hospitals or in the healthcare units, and we will drive some of those concepts using cases that have stood the test of time, both from India-centric as well as global cases. and we'll learn how to really manage the wait times and the patient experience. Well, that we'll do using both some of the back of the envelope calculations, some theoretical qualitative discussions, but more so we will drive our foundations using simulations. So we'll be using simulations where all the participants will be engaged in breakout sessions and doing some of the simulations to figure out what kind of configuration they would really like to have to improve the patient experience. That's on the second piece of it. And linking to some of the things that Professor Chakravarti was just talking about in terms of benchmarking performance, I think today we don't really compromise on performance. Some hospitals may have capacity, spare capacity. Some may be really starving for capacity. Some may be doing exceptionally well with 100 beds. Some may be doing really poor with even 10,000 beds, right, or even 1,000 beds. So how do you benchmark the performance of the healthcare facilities is something I would also like to touch upon in the later part of the course, so that you also prepared not only for your own unit, but if you're owning multiple units, you'll be able to see how efficient are each of the units in running their operations. Always, you know, I always keep talking about operations is more like squeezing more from less, right? So how can we really squeeze more with given your inputs, or how do you optimize the inputs to really maximize your outputs with the minimum requirements? That's on the later piece of the operations part of it. So in sum, I think we will equip you with the tools and techniques that can help you to better manage your patient experience or your customer experience, and without any compromise on the quality part of it. So quality is paramount, but we also believe both speed and cost are equally important from the patient perspective. So that's some of the topics that we'll be driving in the service operations course.